Thank you. Thank you very much, Kelly. I'm honored to be here today. I've, like I said, as Kelly mentioned, I've known her since, I guess, what, about 2010, maybe about around there when you were heading the Confucius Institute. I've been a professor at Texas A&M since 1992. I began my career at UT Austin in 1970. In fact, I came home from Vietnam, picked up my two little children and my wife, who's sitting in the back row, in San Francisco, and we drove right to Austin, and I began teaching there for 18 years, and then I moved to Cornell for 4 years, and then moved back to College Station, or back to Texas. So the answer, I'll give the answer, and then you can leave. No, there will not be a baby boom, and yes, there will be an economic bust. That's what I'm going to lead to. I've been studying China since 1981, when China first began sending students to the United States. Three Chinese students showed up at my office at University of Texas. And so I've been to China now almost 40 times. Three of my demography students whom I've taught, Chinese students who are now in China, three of them were among the five or six academicians who were instrumental last year in getting the government to do away with the one-child policy. So I'm very, very pleased about that. What I'm going to do today is, since Kelly asked me to give a little bit of a focus on the policy, I thought I would give a little bit of a review of the population policies in China, and then how they were interrupted by the Great Leap Forward and by the Cultural Revolution. And the consequences of those policies and the real quick reduction in fertility from 6 babies per woman down now to, the government says 1.7 babies, but it's probably more like 1.4. The consequences are, these are just a couple of them, and I don't know whether I'm going to read these, since Kelly wants me to finish by 7:40, I don't know that I'll have all of this. Okay, so everything starts when Mao Zedong took over the country in 1949. Very, very poor country. 10% of the population was urban. Mao wanted the population to grow. Overpopulation is not a problem in China. It's only a problem in capitalist societies. But the first census came out in 1953, and some people were a little bit concerned about the possible growth of the population. Here's some what China looked like. Look at this infant mortality rate. 200 babies would die before they were a year of age per 1,000 babies born. That's an incredibly high infant mortality rate, and that's what China, 1950, that's what China was experiencing. Like I said, it's very, very poor, very, very backward demographically country. Whereas today, the infant mortality rates all the way down to 12. Now we're at 6, Japan is 2, so US is not doing so well either, but it's a great improvement. Here's what the urban population looks like. Today, in 1949, when Mao Zedong took over, 10% of the population was urban. Now it's 50%, it'll likely be 70% by the year 2050. The blue line is the United States. Here's what life expectancy at birth, another issue that demographers are concerned with. A Chinese baby, a baby born in China in 1949, on average could expect to live 35 years. That's historically what the numbers used to be. Now a baby born in China can expect to live 71 years in the year 2000, and babies born in the year 2015, last year, could expect to live male 73, girl 78. Now it's not as good as United States, 76 and 81, but then we're not as good as Japan, 80 and 87. But just to give you some idea of the demographic changes that have occurred in the time since Mao Zedong took over. Now here's a guy a lot of people don't know about, Ma Yuanchu. He was trained in the United States, went to PhD from Columbia, was the president of Peking University, and he wrote a book called New Population Theory. And in that book, he argued that China's got to be careful because population growth will not be good, and it's up to the government to control the size of the population. And later on, China's one-child policy in 1979 drew heavily on Mao's writings. But Mao Zedong said the opposite. Mao Zedong said population growth, as long as there are people, any miracles can be performed. Population problems are only a problem of capitalist societies. Ma said population growth should be brought in line. So you can see how Ma and Mao got against each other. And since Mao was a leader, Ma Yinshu was anti-Marxist. You've seen these terms, bourgeois theory. And he was then fired from Peking University and sent out to the countryside. He was brought back in when the Chinese realized they needed to do something with population growth. And now here's a statue in his hometown. The street where his residence used to be is called Famous Man Street. So he's highly regarded now. But he suffered pretty seriously for 10 or 15 years. So the first policy, despite Mao Zedong's hesitancy about the importance, about needing more people, a policy was established, which really was based a little bit on Ma Yinshu. And Zhou Enlai was the more moderate person leading China, so he supported this as well. So Mao's famous statement was overlooked a little bit. And birth planning began, abortion restrictions were relaxed. And by 1956, a national policy was actually underway in China. But it lasted just for a couple of years because in 1958, Mao Zedong established the Great Leap Forward, which required a large rural labor force. So Mao's leftist view of accepting population as an asset and not trying to control it then gained prominence, and the first campaign only lasted for 2 years. I don't need to go into a lot of discussion with you guys on the Great Leap Forward. You know what happened there. Mao Zedong wanted China to leap ahead and surpass all the Western countries and to do it real, real quickly. And oftentimes you hear about these iron works smelting procedures that were set up in the villages, and they were not at all good. And a lot of attention was focused on them instead of attention in the rural areas. And as many as 45 million people died in that three-year period. 45 million people in addition to the normal deaths because of the famine, which resulted as a consequence of all the attention on this producing steel and iron and instead of agricultural pursuits. Mao started this because he wanted more control. The Chinese peasantry was very, very docile. A whole bunch of things went on. And just to say that the Great Leap Forward interrupted that first family planning campaign. China was also trying to emulate the Soviet Union. Urbanization was outstripping industrialization, and that now we say that the economic remedy here would have been to slow down the rate of investment in heavy industry, but instead the Great Leap Forward was set forth. It was a mighty campaign, around-the-clock labor. 650 million Chinese people were mobilized. And one feat that was most publicized abroad was the campaign begun to produce steel from small backyard smelters, and with no guidance, no equipment, and it was very, very much unusable. I have a picture here. Well, that's a little one there too. Well, here's Mao Zedong talking to the peasants about the Great Leap Forward, and Chinese demonstrators supporting the Great Leap Forward. And all the iron had to be contributed. Here we have some idea here, and thousands of stoves were used to make iron in the public communities, and it was bad iron, it was not usable, and all this attention was taken away from agriculture and 45, 50 million deaths. The propaganda boasted of miraculous agricultural yields. After this photo was shown, we began then to see that these children are standing on benches, and it looks as if this is agricultural production. But the benches are hidden by the grain. So you had a severe economic crisis. There also, and then as I said, 45 million people died who should not have died. There were some adverse weather conditions. Mao Zedong blamed the issues on the bad weather, but a lot of it was just bad planning. 45 million people. Well, by end of 61, China recovered from the Great Leap Forward. The fertility rate jumped up. Let me show you. The fertility rate jumped up from six babies. Oh, by the way, so this is China. This big drop in fertility, that's occurring during the Great Leap Forward. When you're starving to death, women aren't producing eggs, and the libido, the desire to have sex among men and women, goes away almost. So you had a tremendous drop in the birth rate. But then China then recovered in 1961, and look at the fertility rate. It was over seven babies per woman. So they started their second. They started their second fertility policy. China resumed the family planning program. The birth planning office of the State Council was established in 1964. Abortion restrictions were relaxed. And the second campaign began to have some impact. But then what happens in 1968? Mao steps in a second time and gets the Cultural Revolution started. And there is virtually no birth planning work for the next 4 years, beginning 1966. Cultural Revolution, this occurred during Mao's last decade of life. He saw a lot of domestic political struggles occurring. He was being blamed for the issues of the Great Leap Forward. He was losing power. He feared a revival, I say here, of the ruling classes in the villages, and began the Cultural Revolution. And it went on for 10 years, but the first 1966 to 1970, 1971 were the major years when the schools were shut down. Many of my Chinese students, older Chinese students, not anymore, but they're coming to Texas now at age 26, 27. But in 1981, I had Chinese students coming in at age 30, 35, and they had spent 9 or 10 years in the Cultural Revolution. Some of them were members of what was called the Forgotten Generation. The schools closed down for 3 or 4 years in China. So these are some of the reasons why Mao established the Cultural Revolution and provided the youths with a revolutionary experience. And here he is launching the revolution. And the kids were called the Red Guards. They were excused from schools entirely, allowed to ride for free on trains all over China and to get after the professors and all the leaders. And you know much about that already. And he also put together a coalition of associates to help him, including his wife, Jiang Qing. Here's a picture of her with a bunch of other Chinese communists. And the Little Red Book. This, by the way, this Wang Daiqiang used to be a Houston Chronicle writer, and a lot of very interesting photos are on his page. But here's the Little Red Book, all the quotations of Mao. Here they are, here are the children studying it. So 1971, the one Xi Shao policy began. And this was stressing later marriages, longer intervals between children and fewer children. And this was really the first, although it's the third, it was really the first nationwide program that was in existence for more than a couple of years and which had a tremendously influential effect. Implemented countrywide with extensive local controls, recommending two children for urban couples and three for rural couples. Hugely, hugely successful. I'll show you that chart again. The birth rate, the fertility rate dropped from six babies per woman in 1971 down to about 2.5 babies per woman in 1978. 1979, hugely successful. The Wan Shi Shao. We don't think about this as it's always the one-child policy we hear about, but this was the policy that preceded the one-child policy. Also, at the time, there was not a comprehensive health system in effect, and the Chinese began the issue of the barefoot doctors. This really began a little bit during the times of the Great Leap Forward. These were not formally trained medical graduates, but were young people, oftentimes women. Maybe many had a high school education and had received some very basic and very limited training. Every county, there's about 2,500 counties, every county had at least one barefoot doctor, and a lot of contraceptive counseling was used, and they were trained to insert and remove IUDs, deliver babies, provide contraceptive education. So the one she shall policy and its propaganda, and the propaganda followed what Ma Yinshu, the president of Peking who'd been sent away, he focused so much on propaganda as a way to get the people into contraception and birth planning. The Barefoot Doctors Program, which was had a heavy medical influence, plus the beginnings of socioeconomic development, which were also beginning in the 1970s. And when Mao died in 1976, he brings in Deng Xiaoping, and Deng Xiaoping then opens up the country economically. And we tend to overlook that. In late 1970s, sure, the policy, the Wan Qixiao policy began in 71, the Wan Qixiao policy began in 79. People sometimes think, gee, that reduction in fertility is due to the policies. The medical advances, beginning with the barefoot doctors, and then the socioeconomic development, women beginning to work outside the home, educational opportunities for women. These had tremendous impacts on the fertility rate. Dropping the number of babies per woman in 8 years from six just to just over two. Here are the barefoot doctors, pictures of them. They didn't wear shoes. That's why they're called barefoot. This girl here didn't have shoes. This is very, very, very important within the whole fertility transition in China from six babies per woman down to two. You've got the Wan Qixiao policy and the propaganda, the barefoot doctors and the medical developments, and then the socioeconomic changes as China became more modernized. Barefoot doctors are everywhere, and rural cooperative medical treatment brings new services. And individual incentives for sterilization were a big piece of the Wan Qixiao policy. The decision when to have a child became a public affair. It involved getting permission to become pregnant from your danwei, your work unit. This next slide, well, let me get back. Yeah, okay, this is the guy who got it all started. He's not a demographer, not a social scientist, but a rocket scientist, Song Jian. Born in Shandong Province, 1931. Fluent Chinese, English, Russian. He was the guy, his group in Beijing did some population projections and saw that China was going to exceed the 1.2 billion that they were hoping to reach in the year 2000. If only the Wan Qixiao policy was maintained. He visited Texas, and here's a picture of him and me. Look at me here with the black hair. But here's Song Jian. We were living in Austin then, and my wife and I had a party for him. And his hair is a lot darker than, well, no, still pretty dark there too, okay. Mine's darker than it is there than it was then. And Januzzi, who's an economist at UT. So the one-child policy of Song Jian was then established in 1979. The principal goal was to eliminate births of three per family and to encourage families to have no more than one child, especially those in the urban areas. Women were sterilized after a second baby. Each year, the preferred number of births was determined by the country. China now is having about 15 million births per year. Back in the 1970s, early 80s, they were having fewer than 15 million. But they would say, this is the number we're going to have in the whole country. And those millions were then sent down to the provinces, and each province got an allocation. And then all the counties in every province got an allocation. And then all the danweis in the counties got an allocation. And you would go to your danwei and get permission to have a baby. And only a married couple could request permission from the work unit to have a birth. This little slide says the same thing. Birth quotas were passed downwards through the administrative hierarchy until each small group, each small work unit, received its allocated number of births. So decisions regarding family size became, talk about Ma Yin-shu saying the state should have a role. This is just entire state intervention in terms of birth planning and all kinds of group pressures. Because if a woman became pregnant and she didn't have permission and that baby was born, that would then take one away from somebody else who was maybe in line next year to have a baby. So one of my Chinese students who went back to China in 1986 worked with a family planning group before he came to Texas and used to tell me how the family planning workers would visit a woman who's pregnant without permission and say, you know, you've got to think about your Donway, you've got to not have that baby. And I tell my undergraduate students about these experiences. They just can't believe that this kind of thing could happen. There's more than simple propaganda. There is social pressures to isolate the individual woman, to shame her into having an abortion if she was having a baby without a pregnancy without permission. Women were pressured to use especially IUDs and then especially after tuberous sterilization. Here are some Chinese propaganda posters. We need only one good baby. It's the same to have a daughter or a son. The one-child policy is a means to a rich life. One child, prosperous life. Up agricultural production, down population increase. These are the propaganda pictures from, there's loads of them to get a good feeling for, again, Ma Yin-shu's ideas about the state intervening in terms of telling people how many babies they should have and how many babies the country should have. The party should set an example of having only one child. It's better to marry and have children at a mature age. Just to give an idea of some of the propaganda that was so influential in the Wan Shixiao policy. Although these are more propaganda pictures from the one child policy. Now here is what happened. It's really a mistake to talk about a one child policy, because the one child policy here. So here Wan Shixiao, 71 to 79. For four or five years, from 79 to 84, indeed there was a one-child policy, with very few exceptions. But then, about 1985, a second child was allowed in rural areas if the first child was a daughter. And there are also a lot of other loopholes set forth. So the one-and-a-half-child policy really ran from 1985 all the way up until about 2029, 2010, 2011. And then in 2013, any couple with an only child parent, with one only child parent, could have two. So we call that a 1.75 policy. And that was in existence for a while, not too long. And then here we go, October of 2015, last year, that's when the government decided to do away with the one child. So now there are no more one child quotas. Now it's two children. This vertical axis here are not fertility rates. This vertical axis here is simply showing the number of children that were being permitted by the different policies. Now, I show this chart here. This is South Korea's in blue. South Korea also went from six babies per woman in the 1960s, and they have a lower fertility rate of child. They're about 1.1 babies per woman right now. And then here's China in the gold. And on an earlier picture, I showed you a similar reduction of fertility with China and with Taiwan. The reason I do that is South Korea and Taiwan had the same experience going from six babies per woman down to under, Taiwan's about 1.0. There was a couple of years back in 2012, 2013, when Taiwan's fertility rate was 0.9, even much lower than China. The reason for showing that is these reductions in Korea and in Taiwan. Now Japan was already quite low. Japan's fertility reductions occurred on the left of the screen, which I don't have on the board. But that's socioeconomic development brought that down. You see, China's reduction, and we say, gee, the policy really worked. The policy had an impact along with the barefoot doctors campaigns and the propaganda, but also socioeconomic change. That was key. And that's why there's not going to be a baby boom. I'm getting ahead of myself. But that's why there's not going to be a baby boom in China. Now, in our country, you guys, look, we went from seven babies in 1800. And rather than doing it in 30 years, we had 140 years to reduce our fertility. And then, of course, after World War II, we had the baby boom, and fertility went up a little bit, and then back down. And our fertility right now is 1.9, 1.8, 1.9, 1.95, much higher than China, much higher than Korea. Now, a lot of this is due to international migration. We let people come into our country who have more babies than the people living here. Mexican and Central American people have maybe 2.5, almost 3 babies per woman, and compared to white people, maybe 1.7. But the interesting thing is here, we had 150 years to establish our culture and our norms and not be so reliant upon a high fertility rate. China, Korea, Taiwan had 30 years, and that's caused some of the problems. So the fertility reduction in China is one of the most dramatic in human history. It was initiated mainly by the Wan Shishao policy, but it was also brought about by China's economic programs. So here's the coincidence. Mao Zedong died in 1976. And Deng Xiaoping, the little guy, assumed control. He opened up the country. Here's a picture of Deng. He was never officially China's, I think it was under 5 feet tall, very, very small. But he opened up China with his so-called socialism with Chinese characteristics. So you had the reduction in fertility, and then just when the one-child policy is starting to get going, then China's opened up to the West. He came to Houston in February 1979. He said his trip to America was triumphant, the honeymoon would continue. He asked a Texas official that he wanted to attend a provincial event, he called it, and they sent him to a rodeo. And here he's getting his hat. But see how small he is. Look at how small he is, but under 5 feet. But a very important person when we're talking about fertility reductions in China and the economic growth. So here are some fertility rates today. China, the government reports it at 1.6. It's probably 1.4 or 1.3. Here we are, United States, 1.8. Niger, Burundi, these are places in sub-Saharan Africa. They're having 6 and 7 babies each today. And here, Macau and Singapore, 0.81. So this is what the fertility situation in the world looks like today. China, it's long, 4,000 years, and I only begin here on this chart with the time of Christ, but hardly any growth at all, really, until during the Qing Dynasty, when finally China surpassed the 400 million population. Before that time, it took all these years to get. Well, actually, you want to go way, way, way back here, right? Way before the time of Christ. And back in 1950, we were at 200 million, China was at 600 million. So 3 times different, China bigger than the United States. And then you can see in this time here, 1970 to 80, this tremendous growth. So now we're talking about a little over 1.3 billion, it'll go a little bit higher, and then it's going to start to drop off. And India is going to probably surpass China, probably in 2030 or so. In ancient China, it took an increase of 14 to 22 million people, took 700 to 1,000 years. In the 1960s and the 70s and 80s, an increase between 14 and 22 million occurred almost every year. Just to give you an idea of how rapidly the country grew. And as I mentioned, China's gonna start tapering off. probably reach a total of about 1.45 billion and then begin to fall back. Now, one of the issues that I'm not going to really have too much time to focus on, 7:33, oh my goodness, I'm thinking of my time, is the unbalanced sex ratio at birth. If there's no messing around with the biology, every society should have and has about 105, 106 boys born per 100 girls. And that then guarantees there are the same number of boys and girls at marriage ages. China has been for many years and is now at about 120. And developments that I put together in terms of how many extra boys does that 120 per 100 girls results in about 45 million extra boys have already been born who won't be able to find girls to marry. All kinds of implications, which I'm not going to have time to discuss. But again, the real, real quick fertility reduction in a situation with heavy sun preference and Confucianism. What did Confucius say? Happiness is a hall full of sons. Having a girl is like throwing water on the ground. Built into the culture in China's reduction went from 6 babies per woman down to under 2 babies per woman in 30 years. Not time to change the cultural norms with regard to son preference. Here is the big issue about why there will be an economic bust. This is what China looked like in 1950. And these are the workers. These are the people 15 to 64. And they were almost half the population, and then 45% of the population were babies, and then a few old people. So this is 1950. Here's what China looks like right now. All of these people are the workers. This is what's called the demographic dividend. China, because of a real quick fertility reduction, still doesn't have a lot of old people. And because of the reduction with very low fertility, you have all of these workers. But as these workers, every five years, this moves up 5. And in another 20 years or so, you're going to have, I'll show you what it looks like. Here's what it's going to look like in 2030, the blue. So all these people up here are the ones who are doing the working right now, and there's not going to be anywhere near the number of workers to do the manufacturing. China is now the world's manufacturer, and in 15 to 20 years, it'll be gone. The demographic dividend will be gone, and China, and what implications does that have for the United States, for other Western countries? Who rely on, I tell my undergraduate students, take off your shirt, take off your coat, and look in the back, and you'll see Made in China. I said, if you do that in 20 years, it's going to be made in someplace else. China will no longer be the world's manufacturer. I have a little YouTube thing, but I won't show it. It just shows how that demographic dividend works up, and then it leaves, it dies off, and it's all gone. But a baby boom, the other question. No. In 2013, the government allowed couples in some province to have 2 children instead of a trial run. In fact, my student, Gu Baocheng, was very instrumental in orchestrating these activities to see what might happen if you allowed women to have 2 children. Would everybody have 2 children? And then we'd have a big increase in fertility. And they braced for thousands of extra births. And the surveys showed that they didn't do it. The women didn't do it. The majority of couples would tell researchers, my students, that they only want 1 child. It's too expensive. They've all got to go to college. It's too expensive to try to raise a second child. Right now, as I said, there are about 16 million babies born in China. It's been about 14, 15, 16 million. About 11 million couples now, under the new plan, are eligible to have a second child. And the government thought, my God, baby boom, all these extra babies. And 1 million women have applied to have babies. It's far from the baby boom that the planners are mainly old Chinese men who are running the country. They had been, officials initially predicted as many as 10 million extra babies, and it looks like the increase will not exceed 1 million. So there's not going to be a big baby boom in China. And why is that the case? You're talking, well, that's the economic bust. Why is that the case? Because you have women who are working in the labor force, who are getting their own money, who are going to school. They're seeing how expensive it is to have to send their children to school. And demographers also refer to this as the low fertility trap. Once a country falls below 1.2, 1.3, even 1.4 babies per woman, there aren't as many women having babies, and you then get, so demographically, there's not as many babies being born, and then sociologically, that's occurring because of advances in education, and so this is just not happening in China. There are not baby booms occurring hardly any place. Countries are putting in loads of money. Singapore has put in millions and millions of dollars to raise. They had a night. They have one night every month for copulation night. And it's going to cause, and you saw the fertility rate, 0.9. So the low fertility trap. And the economic bust, this is the economic bust. The workers, you saw the charts. These just shows the numbers here where the working age population is getting smaller because there aren't any workers at the bottom because the fertility rate's been so low. China's becoming much, much older. This is a way that demographers study dependency. You take the young people per 100, a producer would be somebody between 16 and 64. 0 to 15 are the young people, and then the old people would be 65 and over. So right about now, last year, China's dependency ratio was under 40. 40 dependents per 100 producers. But look at how that's, look at how that's going to then go up in 2015, 16, 17. And what's going up are the older people. The number of babies, the number of young people is going down, and the number of older people is going up. And you can see it right here as well. This just takes the population, the old people, the producers, and the young people. Back in 1950, when Mao Zedong took over, there were no old people to speak of. Now we're talking almost a third of the population. They're getting so bad that China has now a new policy about young people taking care of their parents. A new law established in 2013, elderly parents can now sue their grown children if they don't provide economic and emotional support. There are similar kind of filial responsibility policies in the United States. There's not anything in Texas. And the interesting thing is here that just like China, just like here, it's the sons who provide the money and it's the daughters who provide the emotional support. And you've got all these 41 million boys, maybe more because the sex ratio at birth is still 120, could be 50 million. Can the boys provide the emotional support? I'd hate to rely on our son to provide emotion. He'll provide the money, but it's my daughter who's going to provide the emotional support. Here's an old age home. There aren't many of these in China. A large number of elderly people is not really problematic unless you don't have as many young people. So I have a picture here of what this age dependency. Number of six people, 65 years of age and over, per 100 people, 15 to 64. China is the light blue, but Shanghai, hardly when Mao Zedong took over, under 10 old people per 100 producers. By 2040, half of Shanghai will be old people. So these are tremendous implications with regard to the development. There's not a social security system in China. Lots of implications. So my conclusion, my last slide. So this analysis of the demography of China portrays a situation that really rings with irony. China reduced its fertility rate from 6 or 7 babies per woman to now, I think, about 1.4. But they did it extremely rapidly. We had 150, 160 years to do ours, and we're still not anywhere near 1.3. We're 1.9. But 1.3, so... And also in a context with really, really heavy son preference. Thousands of years, Confucius would say, another thing he said, having a baby is having a girl baby is like weeding another man's field. And this is built into the culture, and they didn't have time to change it. So it was among the most successful fertility reductions, but its success and its speed has raised all kinds of issues. So I say in the end, will Chinese and the world be ready for millions more Chinese elderly and not people to take care of them, and no girls, all boys, and the boys don't know how to provide the emotional support. And will China and the world and the U.S. be ready for a world where China is not the world's manufacturer? These are, and there are other issues involved with urbanization going from 10% to 50%, up to 70% by the year 2030. Then the other big issue we didn't talk about at all was the floating migration. 240 million people move from the countryside into the cities. In China, when you're born, you have a hukou, a household responsibility. If you're a rural resident, you don't get the benefits of the urban. So it's much like undocumented immigrants coming to our country. They could be sent back to the rural countryside. 240 million. So this is the destiny of China. And here's my office at Texas A&M. Thank you very much.
Let me ask the first question, and then we'll pass the baton to you. So you had a slide about the gender imbalance, the 45 to 50 million excess males. I know we didn't have time to go, but just briefly, there's some major implications there. AIDS epidemic, sex trafficking, aggression.
Yeah, listen,
can you,
I mean,
briefly, maybe talk about a couple of those.
I've done some simulation work with a medical demographer, Joseph Tucker. And we published a book called HIV and Gender in China. And just doing some simulations, there's increasing commercial sex for the local people, not for the foreigners. There's been commercial sex for foreigners, but this is for the local people. And then all the floating migrants, these are oftentimes mainly young men who leave their wives or their girlfriends in the rural villages. Tucker and I have estimated that China faces a possibility of a HIV/AIDS epidemic that could rival the situation in sub-Saharan Africa, which is 8% of the world's population in sub-Saharan Africa and 70% of the HIV cases. It's another. So the other piece, Kelly, is with regard to gender inequality. Where I wish I had time to show pictures of the Chinese boys making a one-page resume with their picture and their how much money they have and whether they have a car and a flat, and they place them on the Jade Park, Pat, where we were in out near Renmin University, and they're all, you've seen them. And you see girls walking down to look at the finding the ones, and they take down the cell numbers, or the, I guess the text numbers. So the women are having, they're able to now choose. So I think we're gonna see much more gender equality. You're not gonna see the Confucianism, you know, having girls is like weeding another man's field. That's another big implication, which we didn't really have time to get into, due to the unbalanced sex ratio at birth.
What was a common form of punishment given to people? Is it monetary or data or?
Common form of punishment? If you violate the you have a baby without permission. A penalty. Early on, back in the 90s and 80s, they would call a baby that you had outside of permission a refrigerator baby, because you have to pay a price of about the price of a refrigerator. Now, that's no longer the case. They're fined much, much higher now than sometimes maybe a month, 2 months' salary by having that baby. But plus, the woman also has to assume, if she has that baby, she's got to assume then the pressures from other women who are maybe waiting in line, and you're taking a baby away from us.
So it's mainly monetary, not a data.
Monetary and I think social, from the pressures. Guba Chang, my student there who's done so much work in China, has told me that not only the money, but the women, they know that their women friends who are waiting to have the babies are then going to say, hey, come on, what do you do when you're having a baby without permission? Our Danwei only gets 300 babies this year, and they're all in line, and now you're taking one away. And social also.
That I
don't know. Now, they're not going to get an urban hukou. They're going to get the hukou of the. But maybe if you're in the city, that's a good question. I don't know the answer to that. I don't know the answer to that. They'd have to get some kind of. They'd be a citizen of the city. Now they would not. They would be not allowed to then be in line for education. They'd have to be at the back of the line. Maybe that's what it is. Yeah. if you're a baby outside of the permission system. But that's all now going by the wayside. After 1980.
John,
I have a question.
So as the dependency ratio goes up, how are entrepreneurs responding to the caregiving economic opportunity? And also, are these migrants from the countryside addressing that need for caregiving in the cities?
Okay, so the old age dependency, well, the overall dependency numbers are going up. But whereas 30, 40 years ago, the dependents were mainly young people and very, very few old people, now they're going to be more and more older people.
Right. So how are entrepreneurs responding to that economic opportunity in caregiving? And also, how is perhaps migration from the countryside into the cities addressing that need for caregiving?
I don't know the answer to the first question. But the second question, these are the floating migrants who really are responsible. China could never have become the world's manufacturer relying on the local people. You got 240 million people who came in and are doing what we call in demography the three Ds, the dirty work, dangerous work, and demeaning work. And this is the work that the undocumented immigrants, the Mexican immigrants to our country, they do the three Ds. And the floaters are doing, this is work that the local people don't want to do. And the floaters make more money in the city than they made in the countryside, and they send money back. And the mother and the father in the countryside, my son's he working in Beijing, and he's sending home money for all these festivals. But now, as unemployment begins to go up, the first people going to be fired are the floaters. And they don't want to lose face by going back to their home. Another piece we're not able to focus on, what implications does this have for the United States? Right now, there are more immigrants coming to our country from China than from Mexico. This happened about 2013, 2014. About 130,000 a year coming from China. And Mexico used to be 400,000. It's down now to 110,000. So will China then begin step in and with migration moves into our country and take over the jobs, the 3D jobs? Will they be smuggled in? There's a big smuggling network of Chinese people mainly from Fujian province. And they're called people who smuggle Mexicans in are called coyotes. The Chinese smugglers are called snakeheads, sheto. And they're charging $55,000, $60,000 per person to get them to our country. There's not that many. There are about maybe under 100,000 in our country now, but those could another implication of the great economic development, which happened with the demographic dividend and Deng Xiaoping just happening to come on in 1978 when Mao Zedong died in 76, and then opening up the country. So you've got the fertility reduction occurring and the economic, because suppose Mao Zedong had lived until 86, and Deng never would have come in, Mao never would have opened up the country. You have all these interesting coincidences.
Yes.
I have two questions. I'm just curious, during the whole one-child policy era, would a woman be penalized if she had twins or triplets?
Twins or triplets, if they came at the same time, no. And I guess a twin would come at the same time, sure, yeah. No, they wouldn't.
Okay. And since the country is like graying, so to speak, like the population here at the top is getting larger and larger, do you think that will impact China's like immigration? Like, do you think that will maybe want to, follow people from like poorer countries like Southeast?
Well, one thing they're going to maybe, again, with regard to all these excess boys, you could have, like in South Korea, their sex ratio at birth was as high as 117. It's now back to 107. But in that period of time, they have a million extra boys. The Koreans are rich, and they're mainly urban, so they're bringing in women from other countries to be the wives. These Chinese guys, these 41 million, are mainly from rural areas. They're poor. They don't speak good Mandarin, they don't have much money, nobody, what do we call them in English? They're the bottom of the barrel, nobody wants them. So I don't think foreign-born brides yet will occur, but if as China becomes more urbanized, it could be. I think I'm 75, I wish I was only 45, so I could live a 30 or 40 more years to see what's going to be happening. I tell my students, you're so lucky to be, I'm pointing to my students, they're out here, you look around. who are 20 years old, they're going to live for another 50 years and all the changes they're going
to
see.
To that point, trafficking is already a big issue in China from Cambodia and from other parts of Southeast Asia, isn't that correct?
But not so much of wives.
Right, but for sex trade.
Oh, commercial sex, absolutely. Prostitution, were you referring to that?
No.
That's very heavy. Although you have rural Chinese women and women from some of the less developed Southeast Asian countries, and they're providing the commercial sex. It's just loads of it, loads of it.
So what's happening with the minority populations?
Minorities, about 8% of China are minorities, and about of that 8%, about 25 million of them are Muslim, and but then the rest are Chinese of different culture, of different languages. They're really not minorities like we think of, blacks and Hispanics and they're really Chinese, except for the ones up in the far northwest. Now some of the ones in the far northwest, there's the Uyghur people. There's about 9 million of them, and they've been very instrumental fighting with the Taliban. And there have been Uyghur men who have been imprisoned in Guantanamo. So that whole group up in the northwest wants to separate themselves from China because they're more people of Turkish ancestry. Yeah, during the policies, they were allowed always about one or one and a half more babies. And if they were in the mountainous areas, they were allowed two more babies. But there are only 7 or 8% of them, and they're not well integrated into the country. Yet the minority, most people think Chinese are Chinese, but you've got 8% of them who are not Han, other nationalities, and a bunch of Muslims.
Yes, we have a question here.
Is there a disparity in the aggregators in the urban population and the rural population? Because a lot of people from the rural areas have moved, the younger people moved to the cities to work. So right now, is there a disparity in the average age? And how do the people talking in the rural areas will be older? So how are they surviving? Because there would be a...
I'm not following your question. The urban population is now at 50%.
Right. So,
and it's probably going to be 70%, and the Chinese government is pushing for more and more urban development.
Right, so a lot of people from the rural areas are moving into the cities, so the average age in the rural areas might be higher. So, you know, on the graph...
Yeah, the average age of the... Well, what's happening is they're not moving into the present cities. The Chinese are establishing new big cities.
Right.
And so you're just... Maybe a whole urban, a rural area will become urban.
So my question is, in the rural areas where you probably have more older people, how are they coping?
Yeah. One of my Chinese students, a young woman, she goes back to her hometown, a rural village, and the schools have all closed down because the young children have left, and it's all old people. And the economic growth, and she says, people, that's, you know, Kate, but just one example. I don't really have any numbers that I could make a generalization. But that's really an issue, a real big issue. And the other big issue too is all those cities in Fujian province, where the young people have gone to the United States as undocumented workers, and they send their babies back who were born in the United States and they're U.S. citizens. And I visited these little towns. You see a bunch of old people like me, white-haired people, carrying little babies around. And no young people, because they're all in New York City working in Chinese restaurants, undocumented.
We have a question here.
Yeah, you mentioned the fertility rates dropping in developed countries like Japan and South Korea, and you were using that as an example to show that, you know, probably the fertility rates wouldn't go up, so there's not going to be a baby boom. I mean, there's two Chinas, right? There's the China with rich Western cities, and then there's the rural China. How can the numbers, you know, the one-child policy going away, how come the fertility rates aren't increasing in rural areas?
I'm not following the question.
So,
I'm sorry.
You mentioned a lot of reasons why, now that the one-child policy is gone,
right,
the fertility rates probably wouldn't go up.
Well, no, that's
having
right.
Children is going to be more expensive.
That's right.
If you want to go to college.
And the women don't want to be all of a sudden become baby producers.
Yeah, they want to have a career. So it seems to be more considerations in, you know, the rich coastal cities, right?
And that's
the half the population.
And in the rural areas, you're still talking two and a half. But there aren't as many young women in the rural areas. They've all been, you've got 240 million floating migrants, a whole population, 1.3 billion, so you got a whole bunch of young people, men, and mainly men, but a lot of women who have come into the cities. And there has been a little bit of a higher fertility rate in the countryside, but it's not 5 or 6, it's 2.1, 2.2. So it's a lot of changes have occurred in that real, real quick. Did I get to your question? Okay.
I think we have time for one more question.
How will the history reject this period of China 100 years from now? Inspector?
I think they're going to, well, I'm a demographer, and this was the stupidest thing that a country ever could have done, because the Wan Shi Shao policy was bringing down the birth rate along with socioeconomic development. Deng Xiaoping had already got the economic growth started, and yet they then imposed this one-child policy in 1979. And the Chinese demographers agree that it was a very, very stupid thing to do. You didn't have to do it. You could have had a two-child policy with a later age at first marriage and a longer interval between the first and second babies, and it would have the same result. So I think, and I'm going to be dead in 100 years. Well, you will too. But I think it's going to be this particular policy issue is going to have a... I think it's going to be a very, very stupid decision.
Well, please help me in thanking Dr.